Noxacusis and the cochlea-middle ear relationship. This series of Noxacusis models hypothesizes the relationship between the middle ear research focusing on the acoustic shock symptoms cluster and the cochlear research focusing on the outer hair cell damage that causes type 2 afferent sensitization. As a sufferer, I relate to both areas of research, and although reading them separately suggests a significant disconnect between them, I find there is a very possible relationship between the cochlea and the middle ear in terms of how they interact when it comes to noxacusis. The key areas covered are how an initial acoustic shock may be triggered, why recovery takes so long, and finally, why and how recurring setbacks may be triggered. How an initial acoustic shock may be triggered. This model proposes that the initial acoustic shock is triggered by the sensitization of type 2 afferents due to damaged outer hair cells. It assumes no prior significant cochlear or middle ear damage. Noxious noise enters the cochlea, which then causes outer hair cell damage and type 2 afferent sensitization. Although this leads to possible hearing loss and tinnitus, what is more important, however, is the sensitization of the type 2 afferents. A certain subset of noxacusis symptoms could suggest cochlear damage, in particular the frequency-specific sensitivity and pain that occurs upon directly hearing certain typical high-frequency noises such as clinking plates and cutlery and barking dogs, etc. Damage to outer hair cells in the cochlea and the sensitization of the corresponding type 2 afferents could be responsible for this apparent frequency-specific side of noxacusis. It may suggest symptoms such as an instant, non-lingering pain and sensitivity. This model also proposes that this damage to the cochlea primes it to become susceptible to setbacks once the initial acoustic shock had been seemingly recovered from. Sensitized type 2 afferents send pain signals through the central nervous system that relay back to the middle ear, informing it to protect the cochlea. It results in the hypercontraction of the tensor tympani muscle, leading to the acoustic shock symptoms cluster until the noise discontinues and the middle ear can rest. The severity and duration of the acoustic shock plus the noxious noise exposure time may be significant and could explain varying degrees of damage and symptoms suffered, ranging from no significant damage to middle ear inflammation leading to possible further cochlear damage in the form of outer hair cell damage and type 2 sensitization, as it is proposed that ATP can diffuse through the round window, through to the above, as well as trigeminal nerve sensitization resulting in delayed facial pain, fluctuating tinnitus and possible hearing distortion. There also remains a possibility that due to a heightened neural response to noise, the symptom of TTTS is also present. And although there may be no significant middle ear damage as a result of this acoustic shock, the threat of recurring setbacks is now in place due to the permanent outer hair cell damage and type 2 afferent sensitization, and could also explain the accumulative nature of hearing damage, the worsening of symptoms, and the lowering of the threshold for setbacks over time. If in this scenario the middle ear and cochlea were allowed to rest and recover in silence and return to a tolerable, albeit fragile baseline, as indeed they can do, it is perceived that the threat of setbacks could be neutralized if the damaged outer hair cells could be repaired with a regenerative treatment. A second model differs in that it first proposes that the initial acoustic shock is triggered by the neural response to noxious noise. This time, noxious noise enters the cochlea, which at first sends the sound signals through the central nervous system via type 1 afferents and not type 2, where it then gets perceived to be noxious noise, resulting in a signal being sent to the middle ear, informing it once again to protect the cochlea. It similarly results in the hypercontraction of the tensor tympani muscle, leading to the acoustic shock symptoms cluster, until the noise discontinues and the middle ear is allowed to relax. Importantly here, however, if duration of noise exposure was long enough, the noxious noise may also now have caused possible hearing loss and tinnitus and led to outer hair cell damage and type 2 afferent sensitization in the cochlea. This type 2 sensitization could now further exacerbate the acoustic shock symptoms cluster via the central nervous system, as well as become the potential trigger of frequency specific sensitivity and pain and future setbacks. From here, this model now assumes the same possible outcomes as the previous model, ranging from insignificant inflammation through to the full range of noxacusis symptoms. Ultimately, despite the differences in how these two acoustic shocks are proposedly triggered, the outcomes remain the same. A third causal model could suggest a simultaneous combination of the two. Why recovery takes so long? This model hypothesizes on why it takes so long to recover after an acoustic shock and commences as it may appear directly after the acoustic shock. It assumes that once the middle ear has been damaged by an acoustic shock symptoms cluster, that it is in a state of high inflammation and importantly remains vulnerable to any noise that simply activates the tensor tympani muscle. The fact that it is physically moving at all and unable to immobilize to rest and repair leads to a constant state of re-injury and inflammation that continues to lead to the symptoms of noxacusis. Hence the need to avoid all sound in order to let this damage heal. If there are other reasons why the middle ear may still be active, even during silence, such as blinking, it could add to more reasons why it takes so long to recover from the facial pain symptoms, etc. It further assumes a possible heightened neural response also to any noise, which further puts the middle ear under even more needless and necessary strain. Once noise is typically cut out altogether, or at least very carefully managed, and after sometimes weeks, months, even years of healing, several symptoms appear to calm down significantly as inflammation calms down. The risk of further damage to outer hair cells subsides if indeed middle ear ATP can diffuse through the round window. Fluctuating tinnitus and distortion can subside, as does facial muscle pain and possibly TTTS as well. Importantly, these symptoms do not appear to be permanent. Also, tolerance to non-noxious noise generally increases over time, which could suggest that heightened neural response is also not permanent and does slowly recover. Importantly, however, and according to the research, several things remain damaged in spite of this apparent recovery. Cochlear damage remains in the form of damaged outer hair cells and sensitized type 2 afferents. The trigeminal nerve remains sensitized, and this model also assumes a damaged tensor tympani muscle possibly remains in some form, either torn, pulled or tightened, etc. Why and how recurring setbacks may be triggered. This model proposes that setbacks originate in the cochlea due to existing damage being stimulated by noise, which in turn re-inflames the middle ear and trigeminal nerve due to a possibly still damaged tensor tympani muscle and heightened neural response to noise. This model commences, as it may appear, after a period of reasonably successful recovery and assumes that non-noxious noise is well tolerated once again and continues to grow in tolerance. A fresh exposure to not necessarily noxious in terms of volume, but noxious in terms of frequency noise stimulates the sensitized type 2 afferents in the cochlea. This could explain why certain frequencies appear to cause instant acute pain and sensitivity that then possibly leads to a setback. The nociceptors once again send pain signals through the central nervous system that relay back to the middle ear, where an already sensitive tensor tympani muscle gets put under needless unnecessary strain. And while the noise level might not be sufficient to cause a fresh acoustic shock, it may lead to re-inflammation of the middle ear, leading once again to symptoms such as delayed facial pain and other noxacusis symptoms. It then assumes that running in parallel is the ongoing non-noxious noise, which further puts an already damaged and inflamed middle ear under yet more strain simply by activating the middle ear muscles. Finally, it assumes that there is now also a centralized heightened neural response that is running independently upon exposure to even non-noxious sound. This model could suggest that a centralized heightened neural response to noise may remain even after the initial recovery, that now runs independently upon exposure to even non-noxious noise. If cochlear damage was repaired by a regenerative drug and the middle ear environment was allowed to also recover, the concern would be that the middle ear response to noise remains heightened and could possibly now lead to needless hypercontraction of the tensor tympani muscle and further acoustic shocks at non-noxious noise levels. However, to put a positive spin on this scenario, if the cochlea was now repaired and not subject to any further frequency specific noxious noise damage or stimulation, which importantly for the purpose of these models equates to what a setback essentially is, this may indicate that the middle ear is now only at risk of further damage by a newly perceived heightened neural response across all frequencies. It would presumably be no longer susceptible to its secondary response to frequency-specific ATP stimulation of type 2 afferents in the cochlea, as the damaged outer hair cells have now been regenerated. The fact that tolerance to noise does generally appear to improve as recovery goes on suggests, however, that a heightened neural response may not be permanent. The final model proposes a slightly different theory on what possibly leads to the apparent secondary noxacusis symptoms after a setback. A fresh exposure to frequency-specific noxious noise once again stimulates the sensitized type 2 afferents, leading to a setback, bringing with it the typical symptoms including delayed facial pain and fluctuating tinnitus, etc. Where this model differs is where these symptoms are being triggered from. The nociceptors once again send pain signals through the central nervous system, but here the similarities end, apart from possibly heightening the neural response to noise once again. From here, ATP is released in the cochlea, and the cochlea becomes inflamed as a direct result of the effect of the noise causing ATP release from support cells. The first theory is that the nerve endings of the trigeminal nerve that innervate the cochlea, which are presumably sensitized as a result of the initial acoustic shock, become stimulated by the inflammation, which then proceeds to affect the entire trigeminal nerve and bringing the resulting pain to the facial muscles that it innervates, plus other symptoms. The second theory is that ATP and inflammation diffuse from the cochlea to the middle ear and consequently stimulate the trigeminal nerve via the round window. We know that drugs can diffuse from the middle ear to the cochlea via the round window, and it is suggested that ATP can do this as well. Could it be possible in reverse? Such a pathology would suggest that all symptoms, acute frequency specific pain, delayed facial pain, tinnitus, modulation, and importantly setbacks, are all being triggered by noise exposure to cochlear damage, and therefore put possible cochlear regeneration treatments and cochlear inflammation management treatments may be beneficial. In summary, although it can take weeks, months, or even years, symptoms such as radiating facial pain, fluctuating tinnitus, TTTS, and heightened neural response resulting in a lowered tolerance to noise can and do improve. What cannot be overlooked, however, is the permanent damage that remains no matter how well recovery appears to be going. The trigeminal nerve remains sensitized, and the outer hair cell damage and sensitized type 2 afferents also remain, suggesting that setbacks are possible and likely in the future. There is also the possibility that lingering tensor tympani muscle damage could remain. The degree of likelihood and the possible severity of further setbacks could be relative to the level of damage that the cochlea and middle ear have accumulated over time. Finally, the threat of fresh acoustic shocks being caused by heightened neural responsiveness to noise also possibly remains. However, the fact that tolerance to noise does increase over time suggests this is also not permanent and decreases over time, if indeed it is even a factor. Thank you for watching.